us was so impactful. She had a diagnosis, and it was at a point where she couldn't work every day and needed a little bit of help. But we have a part of missions that's called financial crisis. And so we provided, you know, toys and clothes and all of that for the children. But when she came to the church to pick it up, we had also given her 2 bags of groceries, a Christmas card with a food card in it for when those 2 bags of groceries ran out. And she was so thankful. And that unexpected help just brought up her hope just a little bit more. But just know when you donate to the missions ministry, to that missions ministry offering, that that's what your offering money is doing. It's helping people stay in their homes, keep their lights on. So the more that you commit to missions ministry, that's the more people that we can help.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. God is a good God. He is a wonderful God. The way that we have peace in the times of turbulence and tranquility, God gives us peace because we know that He won't fail us. He won't leave us. He won't forsake us. He'll always be with us. We just need to remember that God won't fail us. Whatever we need, whatever we have, we're thinking about, just remember that God won't fail us. He can't fail. He's a man that cannot lie. So He can't fail us. All of your problems, all of your pain, all of your troubles,
you can give it to Jesus.
All of your worries, all of your cares, even your struggles,
you can give it to Jesus.
'Cause He won't fail, He won't fail, He won't leave you. No, He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't leave you. No, He won't fail. All of your cross, all of your pain, even your troubles,
you can give it to Jesus.
All of your worries, all of your cares, your struggles,
you can give it to Jesus.
He won't,
He won't fail,
He won't fail,
He won't fail.
for you. And he made a way for us. And he opened the way for us. Everything that they went through, God showed it. God showed up. God showed out. I seen it with my own eyes. I seen him in my own life. He keeps every promise. He's never being forsaken. Understand why I'm so happy tonight. God has made a way over and over for me. God has made a way over and over for me. And when I come into the sanctuary, I have no choice but to thank him. I have no choice but that Jesus, I thank you. Jesus, thank you for my strength. I just want to share how good God is. When I came here on Sunday, I was just on a 3-day fast. Nothing to eat or drink for 3 days. But when I tell you, God gave me strength. God showed up because I was worried. I was like, it's on a Sunday. I got to do 2 services. I don't know if I can make it. But God showed up. God showed out. He gave me my strength. He showed up in my house. Sometimes you can't wait to get to church to get what you need. He showed up on time. And I'll just know that in this season of Lent, whatever you're praying and asking God for, trust and believe that he can give it to you. Let your sacrifice be better than your blessing. Don't worry about the fast. Don't worry about the things you have to give up. Just remember what he can do. Just remember that he can make a way. Whatever you're asking for, whatever you're seeking for, trust God. He can make a way. He can make a way. I trust him because I've seen him do it. I trust him because I've seen him work it out. I trust him because I've seen him make a way. When I looked at my wallet and there was nothing in there, but by the end of the month, every bill was paid. When I looked at my bank account and there was no negative, every bill was paid. Every way was made. He can't fail. He can't fail. Come on, that's enough to give God thanks. That's enough to give God thanks. He won't fail. He won't leave you. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't leave you. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't fail. He won't leave. Do you believe that he won't fail? Do you believe that he's always making a way? Just keep the faith.
What an encouraging reminder. What an encouraging reminder. That's why we gather in the middle of the week to both learn and grow in the Word, but also to be reminded, to be encouraged, to be reassured. And with all that life demands from us, and with all that life drains out of us and throws at us, it's good to have a middle of the week opportunity to find out one more time that He won't fail. He keeps every promise. He never forsakes us. He's able and He's willing. And He's trustworthy. Will you just walk upright, call Him noonday or night? He'll be there. He'll be there. There's no need. Come on, let's sing it just one more time. God never fails. Come on, never fails. You just walk upright, call Him new, He'll be there, yes He will. Clap your hands if you believe it. Clap your hands if you know it to be true. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Somebody shout, never fail. Never. Never fail. I don't know what you need Him for. I don't know what you've been praying about. I don't know what's lacking in your life, but God won't fail you. Hallelujah. God bless y'all. Thank you for that reminder. You can be sealed in the Lord's presence. Never. I like that word. Never fail. You can't say that about anybody else. Any and everybody else fails sometimes. God never fails. We serve an unfailing God. All right. Well, come on, I know that's right. Let's get our lesson for tonight. So, 1 John chapter 1 is where we're going to launch tonight. And so there are a couple of kinds of Bible studies, right? And similar to sermons, right? There are sermons and there are Bible studies that are designed to teach us lessons on living, dealing with general life challenges, how we successful in Christ in life, particular topics of interest for our success and for our victory in life. And that can be a long list of topics. how-to. Let's call them how-to lessons. So that's one category, right, of lessons. So you come to church, or you come to Bible study, you say, well, I'm hoping I'll learn how to do something tonight, how to love my enemy, how to save my money, how to manage my time, how to be more kind, how to live and look like Jesus, right? How-to lessons. Then there are lessons that are particularly designed for us to understand what it means to be Christian. They're more theological in nature, and they introduce us. We typically refer to these as doctrinal messages that help us understand and appreciate the doctrine of Christianity. It's more didactic. You used that word the other day, Michael, in nature, in terms of instruction and insight. If we were in a college class, you would probably call this one theory. It would be a theory class, right? So there's theory, and then there's practice, right? So tonight, I'm just setting you up now. I want you to know, tonight, and every once in a while, you know, and Jamal, we had this conversation last week. Every once in a while, I know some of you all say, well, Pastor, go deeper, you know, in terms of theology. And you have to cook for the whole house, right? Because, you know, we all have different, you know, levels of understanding and introduction to, you know, the word. And so, and I try to be mindful of where the different places we may fall on the spectrum of our knowledge of theology and Christian thought. So, having said that, I'm going to pull on you just a little bit tonight as it relates to doctrine, okay? And if there's some parts of the lesson, you say, well, Pastor, that seems like that's a 300-level class. Yeah, you know. Just hang in here, and the more you listen, the more you hear, you kind of put pieces together. So, you know, you get the part that you can get tonight, and don't get too, now, it ain't going to be that deep. But I'm just telling you now, it's going to be a little theology tonight. A little meaty, there you go. So it's a little meaty, And so get your knife and your fork. And you need to cut this a little bit, just a little bit. Okay? Is that all right? Because some of y'all say, oh, Pastor, I want to talk about, can we go deep in terms of the Christian doctrine? Okay, we'll go there tonight. Maybe for the next couple of weeks. All right, so tonight's lesson is titled The Foundation of Our Fellowship. The Foundation of Our Fellowship. And we're going to consider the first chapter of 1 John. Don't worry, we'll still be out on time, just in case you're wondering how long this going to be. Beginning at verse 1, here is what John writes. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our own eyes, which we have looked upon, and our eyes have handled, our hands. I need to clean my windshield. You start calling hands, eyes, you know you need to do something. We have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen it, and bear witness, and show unto you that eternal life, which was with the Father, and was manifested unto us. That which we have seen and heard, declare we unto you. This is King James. That ye also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father, and with his Son, Jesus Christ. And these things write we unto you, that your joy may be full. This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not tell the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, And the blood of Jesus Christ, his Son, cleanseth us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, however, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have not sinned, he closes with this in this chapter, we make him a liar and his word is not in us. So tonight, we learn about the foundation of our fellowship. We say we are Christian and we are members of, some of us, the local church. And then there is what's called the universal church. The universal church is simply the invisible body of Christ throughout the world, wherever people believe and have become a part of the Christian faith. The local church is what we're sitting in tonight. It is where Christians in a particular community come together to learn, to grow, and serve together and represent Christ by being an extension of his body. So we are Christians. We are members of the Christian faith and members of the Christian community. Here and members of a Christian fellowship. But here is the question tonight. The question is, what makes us a part of the fellowship? What authenticates our fellowship? What determines that we are genuinely, without question, a part of, a member of, an authenticated, authorized member of the church, the body of Christ? Now, I'm not a member of any Greek organizations, but I'm sure that those of you who are members of sororities and fraternities, and then there are some who are members, I can't think of what the name of it is called, but, you know, Masons and Eastern Star and, you know, and the like, right? There is some premise, and I'm not here to judge any of that tonight, okay? So don't wait for that, because you're probably waiting. I'm not doing that tonight. I simply alluded to it because I am certain that there are some principle upon which those organizations are founded, and something that you must believe or adhere to become a legitimate member of those organizations. Is that fair? Right? And there's a process when you meet another brother or sister that's a member of that lodge or a member of that sorority or a fraternity, there is an assumption that you believe the same thing about that organization, and that you have gone through the process, and I'm going to use the word of initiation. Cammy, can I say that? I can't say that. Don't ask you. I'm on it. Somebody say I'm on it. All right, thank you. Thank you. Cammy ain't trying to say nothing. She's like, don't ask me nothing. Miss Delta over there. Anywho, I'm sorry, that wasn't necessary. I just put you all in the lesson, all online. He's talking to you. Was he talking to you, Cammy? There is an assumption. Let me hear him get on to this message here. There is an assumption. Isn't that right? As a matter of fact, my son is an Alpha, and a lot of relatives are members of fraternities and sororities. And y'all know the lingo and the epsilon and chapter and you talk about, you know, where you played and your line. I was number one on the such and such line and all that. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, you know what I'm talking about, don't you? Did you pledge? Stop it, Kirk. That's me talking to myself now. So there's just this assumption that you believe something that you all believe, and that this being a part of this organization is founded upon something. Are y'all with me? So I want us to understand tonight at least a part of what it means to be a part of the fellowship of Christians. That if we are Christians, and I'm not questioning anybody's Christianity here tonight, I'm saying, do we truly understand what we all must believe and what we agree to as it relates to Christian doctrine that serves as the foundation for our fellowship? And I think John gives us that in the first chapter of 1 John, John is writing. These are what's called general letters. And I almost had our media ministry to put all the books of the New Testament up on the a screen for us tonight so we can get some show enough learning in. But let me just put it to you like this. If you look at your New Testament, the New Testament, the first four books are the Gospels, right? And they, those four, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and they are all biographies of the life of Jesus. Birth, life, death, burial, resurrection, and ascension. Next book after John, book of Acts. That's a book of history. I'm not going to go into all that it's about. The next book after that, Romans. And then you get these letters, and letters that we call the letters of Paul, the epistles of Paul, right? Romans, Corinthians, Colossians, Thessalonians, Galatians, so on and so forth. Then you get towards the end of the New Testament, and you get what's called the general epistles. Somebody say general epistles. So there's the Pauline epistles. Those were letters written by Paul. That's over two-thirds of the New Testament. Then there is the general epistles, which begins with James, and then 1st and 2nd and 3rd Peter, 1st and 2nd Peter, and then you get now to 1st John. That's where we are now. These general epistles written by the people whose name is on the book. So John wrote this letter, 1st John. He is also John, the son of Zebedee, brother of James, who is a disciple of Jesus Christ. John is the one that calls himself the beloved disciple. And after the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, John was the leader of a church called Ephesus. And he's teaching and establishing doctrine there. And what he discovers in the region, and this is about 90 AD, what he discovers is that there are some notions that come into conflict with Christianity. Keep in mind, Christianity is a relatively new faith, outgrowth of Judaism at that particular time. And there's a lot of philosophies, a lot of ideologies, right, that were floating around the Roman Greco world, the Mediterranean world, and Christianity had to find its identity in the midst of it. Are y'all with me? So now, the foundation of the Christian faith is the fact that all have sinned entered the world through Adam, and sin had to be paid for, and Christ came in the person, or God came in the person of Jesus Christ to give his life on the cross for our sins, right? That's what we say at Christmas time, that God himself came in the flesh. Jesus is God in the flesh. You know what we believe? And he came, he was born, he lived, he taught, he performed miracles, he died on the cross, shed his blood for the forgiveness of our sins. His blood was the offering to God for the propitiation, big word warning, for our sins. And it is our faith in the finished work of Jesus Christ on the cross that constitute our salvation. Is that good? All right. So now, But here was the problem. That was Christianity. Now, keep in mind, it was a relatively new doctrine at that particular time. And so now there were some other notions that refuted, that contradicted that gospel that we believe that I just shared with you. And a big part of what they rejected, Michael, was this whole notion that God came in the flesh in Christ Jesus. And there were two doctrines that were against traditional Christian doctrine. And it was called Gnosticism. You can write this down, Gnosticism. G-N-O-S-T-I-C-I-S-M. I ain't say it right. I had to write it down. Gnosticism. right? Gnosis is where we get our word know from in the Greek, right? And there was another term called asceticism. And here's what they believed. They believed that flesh was evil and that the spirit was good. So God could not have come in the flesh, they said, because flesh is evil. And in order for God to come in the flesh in Christ Jesus, he would have had to be affected by the evilness of the flesh. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Now, I'm setting this up because you understand why John says what he says. And so John has to refute that, because the only way you can embrace Christianity in the traditional sense is we got to believe in the incarnation. That God indeed was in Christ, reconciling the world back to himself. And you take that out of Christianity, you ain't got Christianity. It's like fire. It's one of three things you take out of it, and you can't have fire. You can't have fire without fuel, without oxygen, and without, what's the other thing? And heat. Fuel, that's good. Fuel, and you remove any one of those elements, and you can't have fire. Christianity the same way. You remove the incarnation for Christianity, and you ain't got Christianity no more. We need the incarnation, the crucifixion, and the resurrection. You remove any one of those three, you don't have Christianity. No incarnation, no God coming to save us, because can't nobody down here save us, because we were all full of sin. That's why God had to come and do it himself in the person of Christ Jesus. You take the crucifixion out, then who died for our sins? What pure lamb paid the price for our sins? Who was clean enough, sanctified enough, perfect enough, pure enough to do it? If you take the crucifixion out, you cannot have Christianity. If you have the birth, the incarnation, and the crucifixion, but you take the resurrection out, then death still has victory. That's what sin brought into the world. He brought death into the world. So if you take the resurrection out, we have no victory over death, hell, and the grave. And if you die, the grave wins again. I done got happy. I had to calm down for a minute. I got happy before I even got to the outline. Got happy. Just that quick. Just like that. So we need the incarnation. God was in Christ reconciling the world. Now y'all say it, Pastor. Go a little deeper sometimes. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. So, right? So we need the incarnation. That's what we get at Christmas. And we need the resurrection, the crucifixion. We need Good Friday, and we need Resurrection Sunday. We need Christmas, we need Good Friday, we need Easter. All right, y'all there with me? All right, let's ride. So then what John gives us, three quick things, because the introduction is, I've already about done the lesson, right? All right, so John gives three quick things, right? This is what you're going to write down tonight. He gives us first, Michael, the truth of our fellowship. He gives us the truth. Because we need the truth. Because the truth is what makes you free. And ye shall know the truth. The truth will make you free. The truth of our fellowship. And the way he gives it to us is by first giving us a personal witness. Now remember, John writes these words with the backdrop of what I just told you. He knows that the people that's going to receive this letter have been infiltrated with this Gnosticism and Docetism. He knows that. So he's writing to refute what the Gnostics and the Docetists are trying to say. And so this is what he says in verse 1. This is his personal witness. That which was from the beginning. What is that? What's that which was from the beginning? God and Jesus Christ, the Word. That was from the beginning. Y'all follow me. This is Bible study here. Which we have heard. But we didn't just hear it. We also saw it with our own eyes. We looked upon it. And our hands have handled it of the word of life. John said, I know what they're telling you. that God couldn't have come in the flesh. But I'm a personal witness. I ain't telling you what somebody told me. I'm telling you that I'm telling you what I have heard. I heard him teach. I heard him pray. I heard him say, Father, forgive them. I heard him teach the Beatitudes. I heard him say, I'm the light of the world. I heard him say, I'm the good shepherd. I heard him say, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. I heard him say, I am the resurrection. We heard him. We were right there. Ain't nothing wrong with my ears, John is saying. We heard him and we saw him with our eyes. Now, I know you're trying to be funny. You said, but who else's eyes you going to see it with, John? Now, the reason he said with our own eyes is he wants to be clear that this was not some kind of vision of sorts. That they literally laid eyes on him with their own vision, not some other vision that they were given. We saw him with our own eyes. We saw him heal the sick. We saw him feed multitudes. We saw him raise Lazarus. We saw him heal a man's hand that was withered. We saw a woman healed with the issue of blood. We saw Jairus' daughter. We saw the man let down through the roof. We saw the man by the pool of Bethesda. We saw the water that was turned into wine. We saw lepers cleansed. We saw it and we saw it with our own eyes. I'm sorry, y'all got me all excited. I supposed to be just teaching this thing. And here I go, yelling and screaming because we saw it. We've seen it with our own eyes. Tim, you with me? And then he says, which we have looked upon. That word looked upon, it's a perfect tense verbal clause, which means to gaze upon. We gazed upon it. This wasn't some fleeting thing that happened. Now, this wasn't something that appeared and disappeared. No, we gazed 3.5 years. We walked with him. We talked with him. We were right there with him. I can hear his voice now. I can hear John saying, I can see it now. I remember the conversations. We had meals together. We had fellowship together. We walked from Judea to Galilee together. We crossed over the sea on a boat together. We were always together. 3.5 years. I know what I saw, and I saw what I saw, and I'm saying what I said. Can I teach tonight? This is a personal witness. I'm saying this and I'm gonna move on. You know, that's what attorneys look for. That's what police officers look for. Don't ask me why. I think I know why, but don't ask me why. I like watching the first 48. I just always been interested in, you know. When the homicide detectives show up on the scene, they do two things. First, they examine, get a visual of the body, what perhaps happened to it from just a visual observation. They're not forensics, they're detectives. And they just want to get a look at the situation and see bullet entry, where they fell, how they fell. They're in the car, sitting up, laid down, seat was reclined. You know what I'm saying? And then that's the first thing they look at. The second thing they look for are personal witnesses. They canvassed the neighborhood in the immediate vicinity of the homicide to determine whether somebody was looking out that window on that porch in that house across the street, because what they're going to need to kind of put the pieces together are some personal witnesses. I just love the word, so don't mind me. I've always loved the word. I've always loved it. That's what they look for, personal witnesses. And that's what John gives us. For those of you who think God couldn't have come in the flesh, well, John says, We saw him. We saw him. Yeah, we saw him. We saw him with our eyes, looked upon him, and our hands handled him. After the resurrection, Jesus said, handle me. If you don't think this is me, if you think this is some kind of phantom, some kind of ghost, Jesus said, handle me. Look right there where they pierced me in the side. Look, check my hands out. You don't believe it. You don't believe it. Handle me. Touch me. That's what Kirk Franklin sing that song. Yeah, see if you're real. So John heard. This is the personal witness. All right? This is the truth of our fellowship. There was a personal witness. But then, not only is there a personal witness, there's proof of the word made flesh. Right? And verse 2, he says, for the life was manifested. I got to speed up a little bit. For the life was manifested. The life of Jesus was brought into plain view. It was revealed among us, and we have seen it, and we bear witness. Now here it is, and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. Let me read it in the New Living Translation. This one who is life itself was revealed to us, and we've seen him, and now we testify. Put me on the stand and proclaim to you that he is the one who is eternal life. Now, to appreciate this, you have to go back to the same John's gospel. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. That which was in the beginning was God, and that which was made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And the Word became flesh. The Logos, the Word, became Ketosarka, flesh. And not only did the Word become flesh, but he dwelt among us. He tabernacled with us. He was located among us. He moved in with us. He didn't make some guest appearance, touch the soil of earth, and get out of here. No, he tabernacled with us. He moved into the neighborhood. That's what happened. John is offering us proof of the Word made flesh. So there's the personal witness. Yeah, who am I losing? If I'm losing you, just stand up and say, you losing me, Pastor? And some of y'all praying that nobody does that because you're scared I'm going to go all the way back and re-explain it over. Say, don't you dare say that to him and call him, make him go back over that stuff again. Okay. Personal witness, proof of the Word made flesh. Here's the other thing under the truth of our fellowship, and that is, he gives us the purpose of his writing. The purpose of his writing. Verse 3, we proclaim to you what we ourselves have actually seen and heard. Here it is. Underline these two words, so that. That's the purpose of the writing. We're telling you this, what we have actually seen and what we have actually heard, so that. There's a reason for us telling you this, so that you may have fellowship with us. Isn't that where I started? Yes. What makes us a part of the fellowship? Yes. What makes us a part of the fellowship is that we believe the truth. Yes. And the truth is that God came in the flesh in the person of his son, Jesus Christ, to give his life on the cross for our sins. And John says, we are writing this to you so that you may have fellowship with us. And our fellowship is with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things to you so that you may fully share our joy. We don't want there to be any doubt in your mind about what we are telling you. And that is that God was indeed incarnate in the flesh. Regardless of what you're hearing, I'm telling you, we saw him. We saw him pre-crucifixion, crucifixion, and post-resurrection. We saw him. He appeared unto us and about 500 other people, according to the Gospel of John. Can I tell y'all something? Don't you tell nobody I told you this. The claim of the enemies of the gospel is that somebody stole the body of Jesus. To say, so that they wouldn't say he was resurrected. They say that somebody stole the body. Here's the problem with that theory. Produce a dead body and the claims of Christianity are over. Produce a dead body of Jesus and the claims of Christianity are over. There was not one disciple that was sophisticated enough to pull that off so that the Roman authorities and nobody else in the Mediterranean world could find them. They weren't that sophisticated. Even if the body hadn't been found during their lifetime, it's been 2,000 years. I'm just saying. You want to get rid of the proof of the resurrection? Produce the body. It's quite that. Oh, you can't find him? He'd threw him in the water, he'd have washed ashore by now. If they buried him in a shallow grave, the archaeologists would have dug him up by now. I've been to Israel twice, and archaeologists are all over the place. Somebody would have found one and said it was Jesus. I tell you what happened. He ascended. He rose and he ascended. Okay, move on, Kirk. I want y'all to come back next Wednesday. I don't want y'all to say, I am not doing that again. You must come back. There's a personal witness. There's proof of the word made flesh. And then he gives us the purpose of his writing. That's the truth of our fellowship. The truth of our fellowship is God did come in the flesh. And Jesus did die on the cross for our sins and was resurrected. That's the truth. What's the test of our fellowship? That's the truth of our fellowship. That's what brings us together. That's what we believe. So if anybody asks you, what do you believe as a Christian? Tell them, I believe that I'm a sinner and that God came in the person of Christ Jesus to save me from my sins by dying on the cross and was raised up out of that grave so that I could be made righteous. That's it. That's what we believe. That's what makes us Christian. That's not what makes us Alpha or Omega, you know, or Kappa. That's what makes us Christian. All right? Now, what's the test? Here's the test of our fellowship. Darrell, you with me? Okay. The test of our fellowship. Here it is, verse 5. This is Bible study. This then is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light. That's pure. That's holy. Right? I'm going to make it real simple for you. God is light. God is pure. God is holy. In him there's no sin. He is righteous. All righteous. All right? And in him is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie. And we do not the truth, right? This is the test of the fellowship. We got the truth. The test now is whether or not we walk in the light of who God is and who Jesus is, or do we walk in darkness? And let me make it real simple. To walk in light is to walk in obedience to his command and to walk in a pattern of life that pleases and glorifies him. To walk in darkness doesn't mean that we are, to walk in light doesn't mean that we are sinless, but it does mean we sin less. Huh? And we don't live with unconfessed sin. Those who walk in darkness walk in ignorance, a lack of understanding, and an unwillingness to live our lives in the light of the truth of Jesus Christ. All right? So the test of our fellowship is whether or not we walk in the light or in darkness. But if we walk in the light, verse 7, as he is in the light, we have fellowship. You see that if? If we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us. And that's a constant cleansing. That's an ongoing cleansing, right? So if we walk in the darkness, right? Y'all see that? If we walk, if we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie. But if we walk in the light, I'm sorry to keep you up, Doc. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood, the test of our fellowship is whether we walk in the light or in darkness. Wow. Yes, sir. That's all I'm saying. That's the test. There's no darkness in him. And if we are in him, then we ought to be one living lives that are evident that we are children of the light. Colossians 1 and 13 and 14 says, he has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed us or translated us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood and the forgiveness of sins. So let me give you just this doctrinal example. So there's what's called positional sanctification. Positional sanctification. And then there is practical sanctification. Y'all with me? Yeah. All right. Write this down. There's positional sanctification. And then there's practical sanctification. When, here's the best illustration I can give you right now that comes to mind. Are you ready? You ready for it? Here's the best example I can give you. You come to the altar. You get a license from down there at the circuit court. And you come to the altar. And you exchange vows and rings. And then either justice of the peace or pastor says, by the power invested in me, by the Commonwealth of Virginia, and as a minister of the gospel, I pronounce that you are husband and wife. Therefore, whom God has joined together, let no man put asunder. Sir, if it is your pleasure, you may salute your bride. Right? And then I go in the office and I sign that paperwork. At that moment, at the altar, in God's eyes, you married. You married now. When you take that license, or I send that license down to circuit court, and they put that Virginia seal on it, in the eyes of the Commonwealth of Virginia, according to the law of Virginia, you's married now. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? You are positionally married. But you can be positionally married and go out and live like you ain't married. And that means you're not practically married. You're positionally married. Same thing with sanctification. When we accept Jesus Christ as our sin, we are pronounced then positionally sanctified, positionally righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ. But if I don't live it, I ain't practically righteous, but I am positionally righteous. Thank God for positional righteousness. Because we don't always get it right practically. And I don't mean we ought to take advantage of God's grace, because where sin did abound, grace did much more abound. Where there is true conversion of the heart, there will be a true effort by the soul. The test of our fellowship is whether or not we are striving to walk in the light, or if we're still walking in darkness. That's the simplest way I can put it, so that I don't go too deep and too long on this point and water it down so much until you don't get the gist of it. That's the gist of it. The truth of our fellowship, I'm not going to review it. The test of our fellowship is whether we walk in darkness or in light. I'm not judging your walk. You're not judging my walk. You may be, I don't know. But we ought to always be paying attention to our walk, right? Am I walking in the light or am I walking in darkness? One more scripture and we're going to move on to the third and final point. Ephesians 5, 8 through 14 says, for you were once darkness. This is what Paul says. We were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. So since we are light, now walk as children of light. And have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of those things which are done by them in secret. But all things that are exposed are made manifest by the light, for whatever makes manifest is light. Whatever brings revelation is light. And what Paul is saying is that we've been delivered from darkness. We've been called out of darkness into the marvelous light. So then we ought to live lives that reflect the light of the love and the life of Jesus Christ. Are y'all with me? All right, y'all been a good class tonight, so I'm going to go ahead to this third point and try not to go too long or too deep, all right, so that you'll come back to class next week. Amen. Amen. All right, so we have the truth of our fellowship. There will be a test, the test of our fellowship. And then thirdly, we have the testimony of our fellowship. Are y'all with me now? Yes. All right. The testimony of our fellowship is the fact that we have an awareness of our faults. That's the testimony. We are aware of our faults. Here's what verse 8 says. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. And the truth is not in us. New Living Translation says, if we claim we have no sin, we're only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. The testimony of our fellowship is that we are aware that we have faults. Is that none of us walk or live perfectly. Now, there's no reason not to try to be as righteous as we can be, but if we say we have no sin, we make God a liar, because God said we sin. We're born in sin, shaped in iniquity. All have sinned, come short of the glory of God, right? And even after we are saved. Okay, let me see if I can. You all have heard this before. Trying to think of the first word of our salvation. We're saved. Three tenses of saved, right? We are saved. We're being saved. We shall be saved. We're saved. That's salvation. We are being saved. That's sanctification. We shall be saved. That's glorification. We're saved. We accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior. We're being saved by the power of the Holy Spirit within us. He's sanctifying us daily. That's an ongoing process. Until we leave this world, right? We are saved from the power of sin, from the penalty of sin. We are being saved from the power of sin. We shall be saved from the presence of sin. Y'all got it right. Y'all looking like I can remember all that, Pastor. So, the testimony of our fellowship is we're aware of our faults. John says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. We are aware that we struggle, we strive. We have these two dogs in us, the flesh and the spirit. And the one, what you say, Matthew, the one you feed is the one that's going to grow, right? Our flesh wars against the spirit. Paul said it best. When I would do good, evil is always present. So the good that I would, that I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do, I find then alone my members warring against the law of my mind, bringing my flesh into captivity with sin. Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Who can relate to that? Anybody here relate to that? When I would do good, when I would be kind, when I would be faithful, when I would tell the truth, when I would be humble, when I would restrain myself, when I would say the right words, evil is always present with me, Paul says. He says, therefore the good which I would, that I do not, but the evil which I would not. I mean, when I've tried my best, he says, sometimes that I do, I find then a law in my members, a war in my members, a warring against my spirit. You know, there's this war going. Anybody know anything about that war? Yeah. You ever had them days where you feel super saved? Feel super saved. You read your devotional first thing in the morning. You got up and prayed and read your devotional, cleared your mind and your heart. I'm ready for the day. Who just took my example? You said it. I mean, you all prayed up. You know what I'm saying? Hold to his hand. You know, you just got to the devotional going. You got in the car. Nobody greater. Nobody greater than you, singing all loud in the car. You know what I'm saying? You know? Yeah, you singing the latest and the greatest songs, you know? And that's the, what's wrong with you? What's wrong with you? Let me finish this lesson. When I would do good. And I walked up into this McDonald's and this girl talking crazy to me. Like, I just prayed, little girl. You understand what I'm saying? So I'm trying, you know what I'm saying? Just give him a sandwich while I'm messing around and I'm seeing this morning before I even got to work, messing around with you and this bacon biscuit. You know what I'm saying? I ain't even got to work good. I done prayed up and sung a little. I done had a little mini concert, you know, when I'm doing my hair, you know what I'm saying? You done sung all the latest songs. You know, before we do anything else, we call on you, call you Jesus. Show up, show up. Get over, get over. We call you. You're going right back to the song. You're going right back to the song. Show up, Jesus. Heal when you want to heal. Here's the last part, y'all. Here's the last part. The testimony of our faith is the awareness of our faults, but also the assurance of forgiveness. The assurance of forgiveness. I put these two verses together. We're done, right? If we claim we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves and not living in the truth. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we confess, if we acknowledge, if we agree with God, if we expose it, God will forgive it. If we'll come clean, God will forgive it. If we'll admit it, if we will acknowledge it, it says he's faithful, which means he's dependable and trustworthy, and he's just, he's fair to forgive us of all our sins. And because he's a just God, when he justifies us, we are justified. Are you hearing me? And not only does he forgive us our sins, he will cleanse us from all unrighteousness or all wickedness. And then John felt the need to say it again in verse 10, but if we claim we have not sinned, see, you can't forgive, you can't get forgiveness for something you won't acknowledge. But if we'll acknowledge it, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. That's the foundation of our fellowship. This is what makes us Christian. This is what brings us together as a part of the body of Christ. So we don't have to wonder doctrinally about it. And I hope you got this enough tonight to kind of build on it in the future so that you feel more comfortable, one, with your own understanding of who you are as a believer and as a part of the fellowship of believers, but so that at some point you'll feel comfortable sharing it with others because you feel like you have a firm enough grasp on it. Not that you know it all. Nobody knows it all. I don't know it all. But you can know enough to be comfortable with your relationship with God and the veracity of your Christianity, and also enough to share it with somebody else, all right? So the foundation of our fellowship first starts with the truth, and the truth is that we are sinners, but God did come incarnate in the flesh in the person of his son, Christ Jesus, and die on the cross for our sins, for our forgiveness, for our reconciliation. And he rose again so that we could be made righteous, so that the grave no longer has the final word, right? That's the test. That's the truth. That's the truth. And you shall know the truth. Truth will make you free, right? And the test is now whether we are walking in darkness or in light. Since we know that God is light, and Jesus said, I'm the light of the world. To walk in the light means to walk in truth. That's what it means, right? Or to walk in darkness is to walk in deception and sin. That's the test. That's the test. All right? And then what was the last one? A testimony is that we are aware of our faults and we are assured of forgiveness. Amen. That's the lesson for tonight. That wasn't that bad, was it? Anybody learn something tonight? Did you ever learn something? So, man, I learned something tonight. If you didn't learn anything, forgive me. And I'll try to do better next time. All right. Now I do like, because there's no other opportunity for Q&A and any other setting in our church, I really like to try to maintain this practice, but I'm gonna need you to speak to the lesson. Question or comment to the lesson. Is that fair? Yes. Okay, all right, quickly, one or two, question or comment directly related to the lesson of something I refer to from tonight's lesson. And you have to come to the mic because you have to be seen and heard by the virtual audience. All right. Well, that means either you have no... All right, here comes a question or a comment from the Reverend Michael M. Smith.
One thing that really jumped out was the ongoing cleansing that we received through the blood of Jesus. Mm-hmm. And just as you were teaching that, I considered the fact that this body that we're in is constantly growing, and as mm-hmm. a result, the skin is constantly growing, and then there's always this bit of dead skin that comes off when we shower. So no matter how effective a bath is, you gotta take another one.
Ooh, that's good.
Because
that's real good. That's real good. And you know what's interesting about that is how surprised, I don't know about you, how surprised we are. I like white washcloths for some reason. And it's interesting how you can go to bed after taking a shower, get up in the morning. You ain't been outside, you just been in the bed. And go in the bathroom and wash your face in the morning. And you say, well, where did this come from? Because it's in the atmosphere. Isn't it in the atmosphere? Sin is in the atmosphere. And so we need a constant cleansing spiritually through the blood of Jesus, just as we do. Thank you, Michael. Great comment. Great observation. All right. Jamal, are you coming?
Yeah.
All right. Come on, and then we're going to wrap up. All right.
Minister Sandra is the fault.
All right. Well, we'll blame her. Okay.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening. So good evening.
Just on fellowship progressively, uh-huh. You stretched it. So fellowship, the basis for
right.
Christians is love, right? And so as we mature in our fellowship,
mm-hmm.
it looks a little different. So I use Jesus to Peter as an example, and then mm-hmm. Paul to Peter, right? So as we mature in our fellowship and we grow spiritually, it doesn't mean we always agree. There was a point where I believe Paul had to split with
John Mark.
Yes, because there was a disagreement. It didn't mm-hmm. change the love. It's just like, if you roll in with him, I can't roll with you mm-hmm. type of thing. But then there's also a piece where in that fellowship, there's a closeness, there's a tight-knit bond. If mm-hmm. I see you tripping, because Paul did this to Peter, mm-hmm. yo, you tripping. And now you have to be able to give that constructive criticism and receive it mm-hmm. out of love. Mm-hmm. So fellowship is great, but it doesn't always mean we're all hugs and kisses, right? It also means sometimes I have to challenge, mm-hmm. you know, the way I'm living or somebody else is living.
So that is a part of being in the fellowship. John's going to deal with that a little bit later. But there's also the Barnabas of the relationship, right? When Paul and John Mark fell out, Barnabas, the encourager, was there to minister to the both of them to bring that relationship back together. And so that's also a part of the gifts and the spirit in the body of Christ, right? That mender, that one who can challenge and help bring people back together. And so I'll close by saying this. We need each other. We all need each other in the body of Christ. We all need each other. I don't care how new you may be, how young you may be in the faith. You are just as much an important part of the body of Christ and the fellowship of believers as anyone else. And my challenge to us at this point, my challenge to us is to really pray against selfishness, because it's so easy for us just to be satisfied with getting what we need for our relationship with Christ and not concerned about the health of the fellowship. How well is the person sitting behind me doing, sitting next to me? How can I help the fellowship be as healthy as it can be and the members of the fellowship be as healthy as we can be individually, so that we can be a bright light to the world and so that we can be a lot of salt to the earth, right? And so you are an important part of the fellowship. You believer, you sister, you brother, know that truth, and let's walk in it. So you've received the word tonight online here in the sanctuary. Appreciate you being here. This is how we learn and grow. We don't engage quite like this on Sunday morning. A little bit more intimate and this setting, opportunity to ask questions and a little bit more instructional. So maybe you're here tonight, you've received the gospel, you've received the truth of our fellowship, that indeed we are sinners and that Christ came, God in the flesh, to save us from our sins. And he did so by his death on the cross for our sins, overcame death, hell, and the grave. It is putting our faith in that that brings us into right relationship with God, into the fellowship of believers. If, in fact, you are ready tonight to accept Christ as Savior and to embrace the truth of our fellowship, of Christian fellowship and Christian doctrine and belief, this is the time you can make that decision. There are ministers and counselors that are standing ready to receive you. You simply lift up your hand or stand. One of them they'll meet you and take you to a private place, and they'll share with you the plan of salvation. If that's your desire tonight, or if you wish to rededicate or recommit your heart, your life to the Lord, you can do so tonight by simply raising your hand or standing, and one of the counselors will take you and minister to you. If you are interested in becoming a part of Gethsemane, if you feel tonight like, I think I found the right church for me, this is the time also you can make that decision. And if you simply just want more information about it, one of our counselors will take you in that private place for that purpose. If you're watching online and you're ready to give your heart to the Lord and trust the truth of the Christian faith, there's a number on the screen now that you can call, and a counselor, a minister is standing by to receive your call right now. If you simply desire personal prayer for some personal and private need, one of our counselors will gladly take you aside in a private place and pray and pray for you. Okay, God bless. Let's all stand together. I want to encourage you to, you know, make a note of something that enlightened you tonight, you know. Said, you know, that's what I want to hang on to. That's what I want to hang on to. Whatever that point was, that truth was. Maybe you said, man, I never heard that before. Wow, never heard it quite like that before. I need to hold on to this. Even if you just think about it and make a mental note or jot it down so that we can continue to grow. And another way of continuing to grow is sharing it with someone else, another believer. Here's what we talked about in Bible study last night. Here's what I felt enlightened by. And talking about it helps you to internalize it and to remember it. All right? After we pray on your way out, remember you can give an offering. Stewardship members are standing by our exit doors, and you can feel free to give an offering if you feel so led of the Lord. Let's bow together. Lord, how grateful we are for the foundation of our fellowship, that we have a renewed understanding of what makes us Christian, what brings us together, what makes us special, what sets us apart from others who don't know you or trust you or believe the gospel. Thank you for the truth, and I thank you for the test. Show us, reveal to us, help us to see ourselves, whether we are in fact walking in the light or walking in darkness. And if we're walking in darkness, deliver us, convict us, help us, show us the way into the light, that through the light of your word, which is truth, we might learn to walk according to that truth. And we thank you for the testimony, Lord, that we all sin and come short, Lord, and that while we sin less, we're not sinless, but we trust the one who is, and we want to live lives that please you and that inspire the world, that provides a model, an example for the world. And so help us, Lord, to walk in the light and not in darkness. You've called us out of darkness, and you've delivered us into the marvelous light. And if we sin, help us to confess our sins, knowing that you are faithful, Lord, and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I pray for the brother or sister right now who's guilt-ridden, who for some reason feel like they can't be forgiven, Lord, and that you won't forgive. I pray that you will convict their hearts now to know that you are a forgiving God. And we love that about you. And we thank you. Help us never to take advantage of your grace, but Lord, to strive each day to live the way you would have us live. And would you bless us as we depart from this place? Keep us and guide us. We pray for those who are dealing with misfortune, those who know trouble tonight, whatever that trouble might be, or struggle, whatever that struggle might be. We pray for peace and deliverance and guidance and comfort. Now keep us, O God, as we depart from this place. Bring us back together again on Resurrection Sunday as we celebrate, O God, your life and the life we have because of you. In Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. Amen and amen. God bless you. God bless you. You've been a good class. You've been just a good class. Well, thank you very kindly. Bless your heart. Bless your heart.
Do you or someone you know need a ride to church on Sunday morning? Starting Sunday, January 7, 2024, the Transportation Ministry will begin providing free rides to and from church for Sunday morning worship. To schedule a ride, call 757-702-0120. You must call Saturday night by 7 p.m. Call 757-702-0120 to schedule your ride.
Living Waters Ministry provides a place and space where those struggling with substance abuse can share, discuss, and further learn ways to deal with their addiction. Living Waters lessons are faith-based and scripture-supported. They are developed and structured in a curriculum that allows classes and small groups facilitation. Those who attend find growth and strength from the lessons learned and the experiences shared. So come to Living Waters and find the strength and the direction to overcome and sustain your strength against addiction and its grip on your life. Living Waters meets on Fridays at the Garden from 7 to 8:30 p.m.
Prepare to celebrate the resurrection of our King on Easter Sunday. We will celebrate our risen Savior on Sunday, March 31st, at three inspirational services right here in the Garden, 7:30, 9:30, and 11:30 a.m. So go ahead, tell a friend that he died, but he rose again, and bring them with you as we celebrate Easter in the Garden.
Hey family, I know you heard about it.
So join us every Monday.
Seniors at 6 p.m.
Join us at 6 p.m. right here in the Garden.
And the more advanced at 7 p.m.
So get in where you fit in and get